Hello, good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for coming tonight. It's fantastic to see you so enthusiastic that you're already sitting down and ready to start. So, you know Nicole and Scott very well. They're going to have this fantastic talk tonight about virtual reality. They are the interior design team of 3D Read Architects in Glasgow. I was very excited when they suggested this topic, and I'm very excited to see you guys were excited too, because the numbers for tonight are supposed to be very good. Actually, the best ones we've ever had for our Design Pop-Up talk. So thank you very much for you too. So I'll leave the floor to these very talented two people, and then we can have Q&A after that. So if you've got questions, just note them down, and we can ask them when this is finished. This is going to be filmed and it's going to be part of our YouTube channel. And as well, there's going to be a write-up on our website. So if you want to share the information with the colleagues after tonight, we'll let you know where to find all everything shortly. So hope you enjoy it. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. So yeah, being filmed, so no pressure, as I said before, double pressure. Just like to say hi for everyone for coming out tonight, and really appreciate you came out tonight to see us. Hopefully it's an interesting chat and we don't bore you too much and it's relevant as well. So I'm Scott Dorrance, this is my colleague Nicole Kearney.
Hello.
Both work for 3D Reads, who were architects and interior designers if you don't know us. We're based in Glasgow office around the corner, but we've got sort of five offices over the UK. So tonight's really just to sort of show you a bit about virtual reality we've been using in interior design and some of the sort of challenges and how we've tackled them over the last, 8 or 9 months, I suppose, since we've been using it.
Yeah.
And hopefully it will maybe give you an insight into VR if you've not used it in interior design specifically. And also just, some of the things we've faced in it and the challenges how we've tackled them as well. So we'll kick on and hopefully, as I say, it'll be interesting and topical and relevant for you.
So I guess, what is virtual reality and how do we use it? So you might have heard of augmented reality and virtual reality before. They're both really good tools to communicate design, but they're both quite different. So augmented reality uses a real world setting. So for example, you could come into a room and you can hold up a screen and you can see the room in its form in front of you, but you could maybe put a bar in it or you could put a new carpet tile in it, and it's quite common on the supplier websites that we all know and use. So that's quite a good tool, but it's not fully immersive. Virtual reality, on the other hand, completely takes over your vision. So it's a completely fictional area that's constructed. And when you put that on, you're completely sent to a new space entirely. And it's evolved over the years. We've seen it, we know it from gaming. But recently, it's become so interactive, you can walk around in it, you can pick up objects, move things around. But the model that we're going to show you, we're not taking that standpoint. What we're doing is you'll stand in one space and you'll be able to jump from area to area and see things. So it's quite good, you don't need to kick the cat or fall over your table because you're just in one area.
Don't worry,
no one's going to be walking around and falling over things. So yes, that's what we would like to show you.
Yeah. So as a practice, we used to do a lot of in-house visualizations, and we obviously, our architecture arm's bigger than our ID arm. So we had specific guys who would do architectural visuals, and then we tried to kind of adapt to do it into ID. We always struggled to get that sort of tactility and just the softness that you need in ID. So we ended up outsourcing most of the interior visuals and found sort of two or three specific companies that we worked with really well over the years, and we could use them. So the visualizer who's done most of the visuals you see on the screen tonight, that we've got this sort of just running in the background currently, it's been the same company that have done these that we've worked with for a good few years. And these are the guys that have sent us up the headset and that have worked on our VR. So the headset's essentially preloaded with the software and then they upload the models onto it as well. So the headset's not limited just to what we're going to show you. You can do gaming on it, you can do anything pretty much with it within that sort of scope. But what we're doing specifically is just say looking at the VR models tonight on it. So how you set it up, Nicole touched on it, you stand in an area, so you have to set it up and set this thing called a guard circle, which you draw a line on the floor, you stand in the center, and it kind of delineates a space, and you can't move out that space. So if you step out of that, that's the kind of virtual world that pins the model and underpins that for the headset. Mm-hmm. And then one of the important things for that as well is the you need to set your height when you go on it. So tonight we're just going to set a generic height, and I'll use Nicole because she's shorter than me, and potentially, Liz, you can't come up, you're quite tall. But yeah, if I put the headset on and I set it to my height, and then I give it to someone, say, who's 5 foot, it looks a lot different for them when you see it, so it might not be as realistic. So it's kind of a key point that once you set it, it's one of those things that you'd really need to be putting on for the user and set it quite often, unless you're, say, doing tonight where it's more a kind of general display. The headset can then be cast to a screen. So what we're going to do tonight is put the headset on, and then what the person's experiencing, they'll obviously get the full VR in the headset, but you'll be able to see what they're seeing on the screen. So our experience with VR came, I guess, by chance last year, working on some of the visuals that appear for AC Marriott over in George Square. We began by usual project. We worked on it, done our mood boards, worked with a client to do the design, and then we went to the stage of doing visuals for it. So we're specifically, with the model, we're looking at the ground floor area and the public area space, walking in reception, going into the bar, the restaurant, cafe, and running through. And what we had to do for that was probably about 8 or 9 visuals. And we had to take key viewpoints for a lot of spaces. It's quite a big expansive space. So because of that, we had to build the complete model, because you can see kind of all these different spaces from it. It's not compartmentalized rooms. So we did that, sent it off, got it signed off by the client, went through a CDR process for the guys in here that work with brands, got it all signed off, which was great, first time, which was unusual for us as well. And then this was sort of pre-Christmas we did this. Yeah. And then a few weeks after we kind of digested everything, Visualizer came back to us and said, have you thought about doing a VR model and doing a VR tour of this space? So first question was, well, how much is that going to cost us? And we came to a bit of a deal with them. They said, well, it'll be a good marketing tool for us because they're still experimenting with it and trying to just, I guess, learn it as well. They're obviously a lot more versed than us. But so they stitched it all together in the space of probably a week or 2 weeks, and then we got it back. So it's one of those things. I've had limited use of VR before. So we used to do a lot of work with 3D Studio Max in-house. We used to use a program called Lumion, if anyone knows that, which we used to do some walkthroughs and try and do fly-throughs, and they were terrible. This is going back maybe 7 or 8 years ago. Really clunky. It looked like Minecraft or Roblox, for those of you who play that or got kids who play it. So we were really skeptical about it, and we're like, okay, well, do it, and we'll see what it looks like, what the output's like. And then when it came back, so every single one of us that tried it, we were quite kind of blown away and really impressed by it. Which was fantastic, because right up until putting the headset on, I was a bit like, yeah, this is going to be a bit clunky. So as I say, we've had great experience with it. And then, as I said, now we've sort of been working with a client on one of the projects who has really benefited from working with us in 3D and designing effectively in 3D and working through that. So it's been pretty good. It's been a bit of a learning curve for us doing that exercise as well. Positives and negatives from that, obviously, but... So that's kind of where we are and sort of how we've got to where we are tonight and what we're talking to you guys about.
We've even got to the point as well where now we're selecting furniture and fabrics and items completely in VR, which is really new to us, because you would always go and see them and you would see all your samples and you'd interact with things. It's a bit odd for us to just not be doing that anymore.
I know. And again, specific clients doing that, I guess, but this guy's very, very into the detail, so we're quite surprised he's actually done that exercise. But I think he likes the scale, spatially, that you get from looking at the different pieces and swapping them out, and there's time in that, but it's worked quite well with this the exercise we've done. So, yeah.
And what we've learned as well through doing this is that actually a virtual reality model is rendered based on 2D visuals. So you have your camera standing point the same way we would do for CGIs, but you create a sphere around it and then you project multiple different directions and you render a handful of visuals from that, and then you stitch those all together, and that then creates your 360 view that you'll see on screen when we switch this over. But the way that it makes it come out from the screen and look so 3D and so realistic is that there's actually two cameras and they're positioned about 40 mils apart. So it's like your natural eye line. So when you put that headset on, you're looking at 2D visuals, but because there's one for each eye, it tricks your brain into seeing it in 3D, and it's really quite effective. So we'd really like to show you it. I would say at this point, if you have any kind of motion sickness or vertigo, maybe don't come up just now, but we do have a chair. We can show you something in it later. That's no problem. Yeah. But Would anybody like to come up and try the headset on, and whatever you see through it will be cast on TV?
Yeah, cast on the screen so everyone can see. So, any volunteers? Who are we getting? Someone we don't know. We know you, Vicky. You'll be trouble.
So, I'm just looking
at Vicky.
You. Not to be heightist.
We had this conversation earlier
you
before we started, and
me.
We were like, no, Vicky.
You can come up.
Yeah.
Thank you for volunteering. Scott, could I take the headset, please? Thank you.
Right.
So, can I have the...
Oh, yeah, the headset's up.
Thank you so much.
Okay. So we'll let Nicole set the headset up first, because it's a bit boring showing you that on screen, and I'll flick it onto it, because we need to set the guard circle, and then cast it over onto the screen. So
yes.
I'll waffle for a couple of minutes explain that. Sorry, what's your name?
Sarah.
So we've got Sarah up, everybody.
Thank
Where
you, Sarah.
Are you from? Where are you from, Sarah?
We'll Space do the one.
Space Solutions. Are you glad to be here tonight?
Yeah.
Tell Waffle.
Where have you been? What have you had to drink?
Yeah.
You're not allowed in. You're not allowed in. Have you had a round before here?
No.
Are you steaming? Are you steaming yet? Because that'll be even better if you're drunk.
It might help. Yeah.
It's really good. We were having this conversation earlier with a couple of people saying they've used these headsets when they've been drunk, and it's been a bit strange as well. So
yeah.
It's funny the feedback you get on people with these things. Usually they've said I'm drunk when I've used it. And
yeah.
So yeah, we've been pretty much sober. I don't think I've ever had it on drunk, which maybe tonight could be the night.
Oh yeah.
So I said Nicole's got to sort of do this guard circle.
Yes.
Which you'll need to move over there, won't you?
I know, I will. I am going to swap with you, if that's okay.
So yeah, I need to set the guard circle and keep it free of obstacles, and then to say set the height for the user as well, and then it's kind of ready to go. But we'll get it right into the model, so it's kind of gets rid of the boring
bits.
So I can
just give you this headset,
the GUI and the user interface.
That's
a bit clunky.
I'm very conscious that I'm staring at a lot of you, but I can't see you. I know.
Yeah, that'd be funny. She takes it off and there's no one left in the room.
Oh,
everyone just goes.
Please don't do that.
Run away.
All of you can sneak off.
I wish I'd thought that earlier, actually, Nicole. That could have
I know,
been
that's
to
very like you.
So.
Everyone, shh. Yeah. Right, is this casting now? Can you see what I'm looking at?
I'm not on this horse yet. I'm waiting. I was waiting on you. You were meant to give
me
a signal.
I think this is casting now.
That's not it yet. That's not it yet.
Welcome to our hotel, guys.
Are you up in it now?
Are we casting now?
Yes. So this is the casting, and then you need to go in and then pick the browser, and then don't update because bad things happen when you update it.
Never update a model,
very, very
especially
nervous,
when you're getting recorded.
So Sarah,
can I
get
you to take my place and pop that on so we can.
Yeah, you've got your bun on as well, so the bun's gonna. It's not designed for buns.
Is that comfortable?
Yeah.
We never
thought
about this.
If I tighten that a wee bit, does that feel better? It's not wiggling around.
Yeah, no,
we never thought about this with buns,
though. So you're now
in the hotel.
Yeah, and we can see you on screen as well. So as you move around, feel free to explore. You can turn on the spot. Don't worry, I won't let you fall over.
you can turn around, look up, look down.
You can do whatever you want. And you can completely turn around, so don't worry. I won't let you fall into any signs.
This is really weird.
So yeah, you can see, so this is actually looking out onto George Street. So George Square's to your right where the windows stop in there. So the building runs along George Street and then runs up John Street to the left. But you can see, so that's the end of the City Chambers building, the council building. And that's one of those things, so when we've been building the models, stuff we've learned is putting in externals is important as the internals, even for interior models. Some of the projects, obviously, if you're in a room in a bedroom, you're on the fourth floor, fifth floor, it's looking out and what you see. So you've done them originally and you didn't have, we just had sort of mock-up sky or white space or external shots. But then when you actually then put in what's in the surrounding fabric, and it becomes a lot more realistic and more tangible.
Yeah.
And we found that sort of quite an important thing that really lifts the model.
Yeah. So what you can do now is if you turn towards me,
right.
Okay, and then do you see that little bit that's floating saying Bar and Lounge? If you move the wee crosshairs that you see on your screen, lift your eyes up a little bit, and stay there, and then move your head, And this is you now moved into a different section. So you can see how you can jump from zone to zone and you don't actually need to walk. So again, yeah. Vases are safe, things are okay, you don't need to worry.
So you can do models where you do walk through and you walk in them, but we'd set these up just because it's quite an expansive space. It was just taking a single viewpoint. Mm-hmm. So you could stand in the middle of the room and then turn.
Yeah, and if you look up, there's skylights, all that's rendered in, all the finishes and things are there. And you know what we're looking at on screen here, it's still great, but it's not as fully immersive as what it is for wearing the headset.
So it's much more detailed. There's a lot more texture and a lot more just materiality and tactility in it. You really put it on and you sort of do feel like you want to touch things. It's pretty impressive. But as I say, the screen's quite good for showing you what they're seeing.
Absolutely.
But it's not the same as putting the headset on.
And if you look now towards the library zone, it'll move you into there. And then from there, we can move to the next section so we can follow it around. So you can feel free to explore in there. Yep. So now you'll see all of your artwork, all of your planting, everything, your cushions, everything in this. It's either been available in a 3D model for 3ds Max or Revit, or it's been modelled by your visualizer. So a lot of these plants had to be made by the visualizer leaf by leaf. So we were favourite people.
Absolutely loves us.
Yeah. So now if you look up into the restaurant and servery area, and again, as soon as it loads, just move your head slightly because it remembers the viewpoint and it'll take you back through. So now feel free to look around and explore in there. So this is the servery area that you're seeing in here. And if you turn around towards me again, you'll see the back of the restaurant. And you can see from this as well where pendant positions are, table positions are. In this hotel, there's some ductworks and some lowered ceilings, as there always is. So you'll see in here that it's been quite a good tool to be able to talk about how those bulkheads meet one another.
Just how things interface and junctions and things, we've sort of found a lot of... Yeah. There's been a lot of gains from just looking at stuff in 3D as we're going through it instead of finding out later on there's a problem. And
If you look down as well, you can see really clearly what the floor finish is. If you look down towards your feet, you won't see your own feet, which is a bit strange.
Yeah, that's the weirdest thing. You go you like
feel
that
like
and
you're
you've got
floating.
Like and no hands. And
it's very strange. So you can see the quality of things in there. It's really great. And you can obviously adjust. You can adjust your lighting temperatures. You can adjust the time of day it is. You can get a completely different experience from
That's been one of the good things as well about doing it is with the lighting. Just setting things at different heights and then seeing how the lighting affects it, which you would do in a 3D model anyway.
Move you into the middle and then there's one other view after that as well.
Okay. Pastries.
Pastries, anyone? They look so real through this.
When you look at it in the headset, it's like they really look like they're crumbling and things. It's amazing.
It's great. It's really good.
So you don't get the same effect on the TV, but it is good just to show you what the user's looking at.
Yeah.
So if your 2Ds are all modelled, let's say all daytime modelled all the same, this thing can turn it to nighttime.
Yeah.
You can render it to nighttime, and then you can have both versions.
So you can set different times of the day and do like what you would do in a CGI, I guess.
But then you can. 2Ds are just done at the same time of day when it's the 2D.
On this model, it has been, it's been done at the same time. And if you look up towards the tree in the headset, you'll see. So on screen, we can see that that's 3D, but when you're wearing the headset, you can see all the branches and see all the leaves.
There's a real kind of depth in the leaves as well and things. It's actually quite a good demonstration when the headset's on to look at that with the planting because you can see kind of right through it and see how deep it is. But again, you can see the set of chambers building coming into the left-hand side there of the view, and then we've got it running up John Street and the visualizer's taken it up there as well to put that in again just to add to the realism.
Yeah.
So it's quite impressive. So it's quite a good tool when you can start to put the externals in and it just connects the space and it feels like it actually is the space.
Yeah.
So it's going to be interesting to stand in this next year when it's finished and see, you know, you kind of feel like you've been in it already. Obviously, this is, we've done a lot more work on this since we did this. Mm-hmm. We've done a lot more detailing work and changed a few things with the client and sort of used it more as a design tool, I guess, and workshopping with it.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting standing in somewhere because we've never ever really done this in this level of detail for a VR in such a big space. Mm-hmm. It's quite interesting.
Thank you so much for being our guinea pig. I will loosen this. I'm just going to touch your back of your head. And I'll secure your bun. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So flick it back.
I will set up. the next.
You're going to put that one on now?
So yes, yeah, so I'll set it up for you.
I'll let Nicole set the next one up. So the next one is my locanda, which is a service apartment block that we're working on behind this building in the square as well. So this has then been a sort of development of what we've done in AC Marriott and seen how it's worked. And we've started to use it for sort of marketing other purposes. And we've had quite a few clients in that we've showed them the headset, we've been chatting to them about the headset mm-hmm. and what you can do with the headset. So everyone's like, oh yeah, I'll have a go, you know, it's a bit of a gimmick kind of thing. Put mm-hmm. it on and then they're quite impressed with it. So we've started using it more, I guess, as a design tool. And my locanda is one we'll show you just now. Been looking at apartments there where we've had a couple of kind of tricky layouts. So it's a 19-storey tower. There's three levels in the sort of basement to first, second floor. Front of house, F&B. We've got a gym, etc. in there as well. And then levels 3 to 19, it's pretty much a standardised block of apartments all kind of mirroring one another right up. So we've got two really tricky ones in the north corner that are about 26 square metres and they're just spatially been a challenge. So we've kind of got them architecturally sorted out, mainly for the regs and just to get everything working.
Yeah.
But then the client's struggling to understand, it's quite a small space, where's the furniture going, how's it going to look? Mm-hmm. So we suggested to them about, why don't we build a VR model and we'll do it so that we can do different options, we can move things around, put the headset on, and then we can flick between options so that you can stand in the space and see maybe how it's going to affect it and how the design could work. So that's the next one that we're going to flick up.
Yes. Would anybody else like to come up and see this one? It is a slightly different model, but does anybody want to come up and try it? If there's no takers, I'll do it, don't worry. But does anyone want to experience
it? Come on, get someone up for the back, yeah. Someone come up, yeah. Stripe it off.
That was a very energetic wave, I liked it.
That's enthusiasm. That's what 10 Prosecco's does, that's good.
So I have a challenge here, not I need reading glasses. So does that work?
Let's figure it out.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. Just don't walk into that because Sarah's just got that. It's new.
Yes. Right.
Don't break it.
Well, okay.
Don't break it.
Yep. So I will get you to swap places with me again, just the same.
So go over here, yep, so back into this.
Can I give you that?
Yep.
So I'll get you to stand just here and I will pop this on your head. And feel free to position that until it's comfortable. And then I'll tighten it a little bit just so that it doesn't fall off. Does that feel comfortable? Does it feel tight enough?
That's fine. That's
fine. Okay. Right. So.
It is completely out of focus though.
Oh, is it? Have you moved? See, this is where the interesting bit is. I'm now at this side and I'm going to put a controller in your hand and I'm going to tell you how we're going to set this up, okay? So.
I can't see anything.
That's part of the fun. So what I'm going to get you to do is point at that screen
and
just press that little button that your thumb's over just now.
This screen?
Yep.
Yep, so press it on that, on the screen, and then that'll take you into the model.
Is it working for you?
It's just, so, yeah.
Oh, just, you don't need to hold it in, you just need to press it once. There we go.
But we're going to have IT problems
there. And I'll take that from you. Okay, and I'll move back to this side so I don't scare you by my voice moving.
So we did this, as I say, as a white space model, the reason being we were using it as a tool, so we wanted to keep the cost down and try and see, instead of going to a full rendered model, there's obviously more cost in rendering it. And because we're looking at different options, we wanted to try and keep the cost back for the client. So this is in one of the apartments, and it's a slightly different model where we've got a you have that crosshatch where you can go between the views that we showed you another one and take you to room to room. Mm-hmm. We still have that here, but we've also got, there's a tab bar down the bottom when you look down and it gives you an A and B option in this one. So in one of the apartments we've got
look towards the kitchen, then look down to the floor.
So if you focus on that A and B. If you lift your head up a little bit, you'll see there's A and B.
So down a tiny bit.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so just stay looking at that. There we go. Right. So now you'll see that there's a different handling and a smaller kitchen.
So we tried smaller kitchen. We've moved this on quite a bit from this one as well and developed it a bit more and put a bit more detail in. But effectively, it was spatially to have a look at this and mm-hmm. see how we could overcome challenges. You can see it's challenging as well.
Don't worry, I won't let you fall over. There's literally
wall windows along two levels. Yep. Quite a small bathroom, to say it's about 26 square metre apartment. So it's trying to do quite a lot of things in quite a small space. So we're at the stage now, probably with a client, where we've picked the option and we've chosen the kitchen. I think we had a standard length kitchen that we'd taken from the standard apartment and put in this. We're getting a pinch point where you come in the lobby. So we started to look at all these things with the client in a bit more detail and try and sort of hit on a final version. And we've found that designing like this as well, we're kind of working in the space and not on the space that we were doing 2D. So I think before we even got to this stage, we probably looked at around 10 layouts for this in CAD. So it's been quite an interesting exercise to try and use this. And as I say, we've done a lot of work with the client on this model as well and developed it with them. So the next stage, we're going to be going to rendering it.
this is the party room. We all stand in the middle of the bed.
So this is the one where you can see then, and working in a much smaller space, it's a bit more difficult because you have to sort of draw a line in the sand and, you know, or stick a flag in the sand and sort of say, I'm going to stand in this point. And then to look around the room, you're obviously wanting to be in the centre of the room, which works great in the AC because you've got a big expansive space. In this, it's a lot tighter in. So it doesn't really give you a true reflection of it. But I think at that one point, it's like you're jumping on the bed and the other of you, it's like a pyjama party before we flip them on. So it's been quite useful to say working on this and just doing different layout options, different kitchens, trying different FF&E to see how that affects the space because it's such a tight space. The rest of the apartments have been fine. This is just the smallest one that we've got in this block.
So it's this 19-storey tower, this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you'll see just outside, it's just base blocks for to illustrate buildings. But yeah, we can eventually, once it's been finalised, what it's going to be, it'll all be rendered to look true to life and the exterior will all be done as well.
Cool.
So, yeah. Thank you so much, Gillian. I will take that comment. It does work. Thank you. It does work. There you go. Thank you so much.
I just went upside down there. That's quite cool.
Without even trying.
Yeah. Sorry, I'll just flick it back into that so I can bore you with that. So as Nicole mentioned, we're just getting ready to choose the final layout with the client just now, and then we're going to properly render up that model for the studio apartment. But then what we're then going to do is the client wants to take the studio apartment and then take a full sort of guest front of house corridor. And then we've got one bed apartments that are bigger at the other end. So the idea will be that you render those three components in the model and you build this space that you're in the studio apartment, you walk around, go in the bathroom, walk out into the corridor, and then you've probably got two views taking you down the corridor to look at the detail in there.
Yeah.
And then you enter into the one bed apartment and then you can view the whole one bed apartment as well.
Yep.
So it's almost like building this space that you can connect to two spaces without kind of fully modeling the whole floor and give them a good enough idea of sort of how it's going to look. So I think, I've totally lost my train of thought there. I just looked at you and I'm like, ah. I've totally lost my train of thought. I apologise.
Don't worry.
I think that's me, actually.
That is you. I've got you. So clients have told us that they've really enjoyed this experience. You know, it's not for everybody, but certainly the people that we've been working with, the majority of them have found this such a useful tool, particularly in the case of awkward details or the smaller apartments that you've seen. And it makes them feel more involved in the design process. Mm. And the really good thing as well is that once this hard work's done, your visuals are all done, they're melded together into this virtual reality model. It's also then extracted as a web link. Hmm. So anyone who's got access to a screen that can connect to the internet can view this. So we've sent this out to our clients that we're working with on these projects. And they can then go around and, you know, you're no longer worried about just the one static perfect view that we all render when we're doing our CGIs. They can look around behind you. Clients have sent me screenshots of little details with little overmarks, and it just makes you think about things a lot quicker. And when it comes to doing tender drawings, you've already worked out skirting details and joinery details because they've been able to turn around and see that little bit that, you know, they want to put some effort into. So it's been really good and really useful for that.
Hmm. And I think as well, just talking about the detail and things, even everyone in the design team can see it. So you've even got like QS's PMs putting on the QS might ask questions that you're like, never even thought of that.
Mm-hmm.
And again, more to do with the detail and just these elements. So it's been pretty good for that as well. So I guess positives, there's quite a few positives that we've found from it. You're obviously designing and working in 3D, as I mentioned earlier, which has been quite good for, you know, ironing out all these problems. The one thing we've obviously seen for being multidisciplinary, working with architects a lot, over the last few years has been Revit and BIM, and you've got the benefit of the clash detection system that the guys will use. So tying in with MEP, structural, where pipes coming in, you've got a column in the road, and you can pick them up quite quickly.
Yeah.
And I think interior designers, we haven't really benefited for that, because I know some of you guys have been working in Revit and interiors, we've not really been doing so much as we should have been. So we've been kind of missing out on that side of things and really integrating all the things in, because they're still sometimes seen as quite separate disciplines. But we've noticed doing a few of these models that a lot of the architectural detailing does have a bigger impact on us. And say Milo Kanda, we've used it to sort of detail out window details where we've had an issue not having the manufacturer on board, the reveal, the curtains, should we do blinds because of the space. So we've found that at an early stage as well. We've managed to kind of overcome these things. And when you've got, 16 levels of apartments, 160 apartments with wall-to-wall windows, it's a massive, massive cost that I don't think it would have taken us probably 6 months down the line to realise this issue, whereas we've sort of done it now and we've ironed it out now, which is quite good. So it's these little things that we're sort of seeing sort of cropping up that have been really helping us, and I guess just seeing the benefit of using it, the technology from there.
How easy is it to change? Because we've got lots of clients that change their mind constantly. This would maybe help iron out some of that. I can't imagine it. But equally, with one particular client I'm thinking about, they could be, can we just try this? Well, can you do that?
That's a good question. That's one of the things, and it's sort of touching it later on the negatives about cost and time. So it could be one of those fantastic, it's a bit like the internet, it's fantastic and it's terrible at the same time, you know, and what it does. But I think when you get to the stage, I think for us having the relationship with the modeler, again, it's that thing that when you're doing CGIs and you know you work with people for years and just getting someone on board that you know you can trust and gets you and understands you, I guess.
Yeah.
It's having that relationship as well. That.
So do you do these all in-house or do you have a separate...
No, we outsource these now. So we used to do a lot of stuff in-house, but to get that quality level, we had to sort of go outside and say work with a few and mistakes and, you know, just learn who was out there who could do the interiors better than a lot of the architectural guys that would try and do the interiors, but it was very, you know, hard and shiny and just not have that tactility. You need to have a soft interior visual, so... So I guess it's these guys have developed with us and they've started doing this in VR and really pushed it and we've built these relationships. So we kind of build in cost, obviously, to allow for so many changes. And depending on who you're working with, you get some clients that will see that first and they'll go, I love that, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Other ones that you will be chasing down the doors for months. And it's I guess it's knowing how to build in that variance into your cost when you see it. So that's what we've kind of learned just with doing the CGIs with certain people when... We've taken that into the VR as well, so but it's a very, very difficult thing to try and manage, as
and
you know.
Having the white space model is a good way to contain it.
Yeah. Oh, no, that's one of the good things. So when you're doing your fee, obviously you can set it out and then say if there's any changes, it costs X, and then that tends to sometimes rein people back in and they make decisions quicker. And
I'd give you a whole bunch of overmarks rather than one at a
time. Yeah. Yeah. That's the great thing about that link. They can mark over the full room, they can look around everything and send you it, and then it's a raft of changes. And it might happen again, you know, it does, more than one occasion it does. But it's great to just hit the ground running with it.
No, it definitely is, yeah.
So would whoever's looking at, let's say your client or QS, whoever, they've got to buy a headset?
Not necessarily.
To view it?
Not necessarily. So yes, to view it in virtual reality, you will need a headset, but they don't necessarily have to buy one. They could come to our office and use this headset, or you know, we could send one to them.
We've posted them out to people as well.
Yeah.
How do you get like still pictures that you can mark over?
You can just take a screen grab. So when you're using the web link, you can take a screen grab of exactly what's being looked at, and then you can mark over it. It's really good. It's
but
almost like when you get a render, you mark over it.
Screen grab while you've got them on.
You can't do it through the headset,
but you can do it through the web link. So you do that on screen.
Yep.
So
you
can
get
view
both.
It on the headset, and then you would need to go to the URL and then screen grab or output it, however you want to do it.
But we've also found as well with sample rooms, there's a really big difference in the cost.
Yeah, so we got quoted on one of the projects. I think it was something like 70 or 80 grand to do a sample room for an apartment. Whereas the cost of doing the model for that sort of varies. It could be between sort of about 8,000 and 10,000 for doing it. So it's not something we necessarily thought about. It was when the clients highlighted it and said, oh, we could maybe not do a sample room instead, and they were happy doing the VR model. again, it depends on the level of detail you've got in it and what project it possibly is. But that's something that could be quite a big cost saving as well. So
yeah.
Again, it's another thing that might, it's one of those things that's gonna, might not happen. There's positives and negatives, but it could be quite a good positive in terms of the cost.
Definitely. And from an environmental point of view as well, if you're not building sample rooms that are gonna get ripped out and not used again, because everything's damaged or you know it's been bumped or whatever it might be, if you're negating the need to build a sample room, then that doesn't need to happen. So it's a really good tool for that as well. And what we found is on one of our projects, our clients are actually going to get kitchen models made up and, you know, a one-off headboard, but they're going to be constructed off-site for approval. So you'll still be able to, you know, approve nitty-gritty things once you've maybe done 25 versions of it to get there. But that's the purpose of the white space models. And then once you've done that, you build it, you approve it, that then gets used in the project, so there's not as much wastage. So it's actually been quite a good benefit to us. And from a marketing point of view as well, the fact that you've got that web link, clients can use that to market their hotels. And another client we're working with that's looking at residential projects is talking about rendering apartments and having them in virtual reality based on what their clients want.
Yeah.
So your client can approach you and say, I want this kitchen, I want this finish. They can come to your showroom, put the headset on and see their house the way they want it. So you can actually buy off virtual reality now rather than off a 2D plan or off a sample house or a sample apartment. So again, it negates that wastage.
Yeah.
Someone's not moving in and then ripping out a kitchen that they didn't want. So it's a real benefit.
They might, if they're rich.
Yeah. Well, they might.
Seen that before, carpets.
They might.
But yeah, I think it'd be quite an interesting way. I think that's one of the good ways that it could be quite a good user experience for, you know, from a private residential domestic point of view as well.
Definitely.
So yeah, it'd be
and
interesting
site
to see how it
visits
develops.
As well are limited. You know, you don't need to go to site to see it. You can have your headset or you can go online. So that's been another good benefit for us as well.
But saying that, there are negatives. Again, things that we've sort of found from working in it and doing different things. Milo Candace, prime example, smaller room. We still feel it's a bit, you have to sort of say take that view. I think you've really got to think about where your views are going to be from in the room. You naturally want to stand when you do those ones in the centre of the space if you're taking a fixed point. And you'll have seen in the bathroom, we had to take the view from the threshold of the door, so you're actually not quite in the room. So you could stand back and see the room. If you stood in the middle of the room, you would be too much on it, which again is not very real when you think if you stood in a space, even in a small space, you can still see everything around you with your peripheral vision. So that's one of the things, but I think it'll be something, it will get designed out, technology will get better, it'll overcome that. It's maybe just to do with the views or maybe taking a slightly lower view. Again, it's experimenting with these things with the visualizer and just sort of seeing and challenging it, because a lot of the things we've found, we've had to go back to them and sort of give them challenges and say, well, when we're doing this, you know, we can't do this, how do we overcome that? And then getting them to sort of tackle the problem. So it's this sort of two-way interface, which has been really good as well. Other negatives, can't review materials really. I mean, we've obviously set up a little bit of a stall there because we're here tomorrow as well with a lot of the materials from AC that's up in the visuals. So again, I guess it's one of those things where typically if you were doing CGIs and stills, you'd have done your mood boards anyway and had them signed off, and then you'd be going to your CGIs with the confidence that most of the finishes were going to, you know, go forward. So it's a very similar thing, but it's just if a client wants that tactility of the walking into the sample room and, you know, taking it in that we've all seen and you're like, this is amazing. You potentially don't get that really with the VR, if I'm being honest. So that's one of the probably the biggest downsides I feel. But again, it might be there's ways to overcome that. There probably is. Another one we were thinking about is live projects. So we've done a lot of work, refurbishments, where you may be doing bedroom wings and the client wants to build a kind of live sample room so they can get the ops team in, they can get guests in, they can get clients in.
Test housekeeping, it
yeah, for cleaning and just, you know, run the taps, try stuff out for 3 months before they then do this and do feedback. We've had quite a lot of projects like that. So you can't do that with that type of project, I wouldn't say. So it's maybe more suited towards new build, where the building doesn't even exist yet, but you can completely imagineer it out of the ground and done what we've done with AC. So there are negatives, but I think it's one of those things. There's always going to be positives and negatives, and it's about turning it around for you. And again, the time and cost that we chatted about, it's having a client as well that I guess wants to invest in it and sees the value in it. It's not going to suit everyone. It's not going to suit every client. There's going to be guys that just are like, I'm not interested, and other people that you know, like it, or whether it's gimmicky or not. You know, they just like that thing of putting it on and saying, I've done this VR, it's amazing. So again, I guess it's trying to see the investment in that and get their buy-in to give you additional fee that you're going to pass on to your visualizer and go that extra mile.
Yeah.
But as we've seen with AC, it was a very, very small uplift from going from having 8 or 9 visuals to building a VR model, because the work had been completely done. So it's a very simple step, whereas a lesser product, maybe a 3-star hotel, you wouldn't take as many views in a bedroom, maybe take 2 views in the bathroom. You might not have enough to stitch together a model without spending double again. So that's maybe another negative, but as I say, they're minor. So,
and your visualizer as well. You know, your visuals are only going to be as good as your visualizer. Yeah. So it's really important when we're looking at this kind of technology and you're investing in it that you get the right person that you can work with, that you know and you trust, and you know you can feed back to really easily. It's always a good process to have. So having this, you know, we've really thought about how this can support us, but not just us as interior designers and architects, but how it can support us in the construction industry and globally, how this technology can evolve. And it's just been fascinating. So there was a report by Fortune Business Insights that found that the global virtual reality market is going to increase from its current value of $6.3 billion to over $84 billion within the next 6 years. So it's crazy. Like, it's really exciting to be involved in it at this point, because it's about to, you know, blow the roof off. So it's great that
we've been mocking each other about this all week, actually.
It's a big number.
It's a big number.
And it's not just globally. In the UK in 2018, the government invested $72 million into a core innovation hub. And that is projected to try and encourage more augmented and virtual reality, specifically within construction. And we found that some contractors so far as well have been using it, but they've not just used it for design, they've used it for things like health and safety training. So we've probably all been to site or will go to site at some point in our careers, and we all know that they're not the safest places to be sometimes. And I think it would really benefit us from going there if everybody that's on site is fully trained in health and safety procedures, they know how to work equipment properly. From a contractor point of view as well, their staff are then properly trained, there's going to be less accidents, their staff will be happier, they'll get a better reputation, they'll get better results. It's going to cost less money because there's not going to be any potential incidents and potential hold-ups on projects as well. So there's some real benefits to it in that regard as well. And I guess the main point for us has really been understanding how much now our client base can expand, because we've broken down so many barriers. We don't need to worry anymore about who can travel where. You know, we can send a headset or we can send a web link, and we can work with clients from anywhere. We can be anywhere while we do it as well. And in the modern world, I think that's a really great thing to be able to do.
Yeah, especially the last couple of years, I think. Things have changed a little bit, and I know we're getting back to normal, but there's always going to be clients that are still not going to be coming out as much.
Totally.
And interfacing with us. So,
and you can be respectful of people's boundaries, and it's accessible to almost everybody. So someone who maybe isn't able to go to site because of isolation or travel restrictions or limited mobility can now experience that. So it's been really interesting for us to see how that can expand.
And it's dead gimmicky at the end of the day. It's just one of those things.
Everyone loves a bit of tech.
You bring them in, you go put the headset on, everyone's like, yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
So it's amazing to see, just people are like children, and they put it on and then they're...
We were walking around the office like kids, it's great.
So it has got that novelty factor still just now. I know it's going to become more commonplace, I guess, and a lot of you are probably using it just now, and you're probably thinking, oh God, we've been doing that for 10 years, guys. But for us, we've really sort of taken to it and used it quite a lot in the last, I guess, 9 or 10 months. So
thank you so much for listening to us. We've really enjoyed talking about it and our experiences. And we'll be here tomorrow as well. We'll have the headset, so please feel free to come and try it. We want you to try it. We won't let you fall over. Maybe.
Maybe.
For laughs. We won't. We're not that mean. But please come and see us. And we'd love to hear as well if you're using it, because that would be great to know how it's going for other people as well.
Does anybody get any questions just now? I know we had a few earlier on, and I know you've
got it.
You've reached your limit. You've got your limit.
Ask away.
Come on.
Can you see when they're building this to start with? Are you doing it from, like, let's say from your point of view from CAD, or if it's an existing site, instead of having to travel to the site, can it be built from photographs?
So to build the model initially. So in order to build the model initially, we would need to have some sort of 2D plan. It's kind of like when you're building your CGIs with your visualizer, they would need to have something to build from. I mean, if they're really, really good and you've got a good reputation with them, you could probably just send them, you know, a photograph of something or a sketch of something. You know, everybody's got their own talents and strengths.
Yeah, we could do it.
Like the first start of a project and going to see a site instead of to travel.
Yes.
In a different country.
Uh-huh.
And if you could just be given that.
Yeah, so to negate having to go to site, definitely you would have a 2D CAD plan and you would just extrude from that.
Yeah.
And you'd build that model based on that and your elevations as well. So we gave our visualizer a full package. It was 2D plans, 2D elevations. We also sent them inspiration images of how we wanted details to look, because you're not going to draw them all up if you're not at that stage yet.
Yeah.
So you can send all of that over and then get a model constructed from that.
But then Mylocanda, just touching back on that as well, which might interest people. So they work in 3D Studio Max, and they ask for 2D, but we've given them Revit models before to do stuff, because we thought initially if we were working in Revit, we could just hand them as much as we could, and then it would reduce, going back to the cost, could drop the cost if we built a lot of the modelling and we'd already done that as part of our work.
Yeah.
But they tend to like to use the Revit for reference. They don't take the Revit and use it as a thing.
Yeah.
As we found, so that was my grand plan scuppered, where I thought I could really
take a lot of time and expense out of it. As well.
Yeah. Yeah, so we thought going forward, if we were more integrated in Revit and we had architecturally done it, interior done it, drawn it up, it would just streamline things. I think that'll come, but as I say, now the ones we're working with prefer to get a better output, putting it back into 3DS and then just using all these things to cross-reference.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I think, as I say, I think it will come and it will start to get streamlined for ID as well. So.
Definitely.
So, yeah.
Definitely. Yes?
Yeah, you touched a couple of things on cost there.
Yes.
Do you know that this is compatible with Google SketchUp, for example, which is a lot quicker and cheaper to churn out like a white model?
Yeah, so with Google SketchUp, you can use a base model. Your visualizer can extract, you know, your 2D and 3D in a lot of cases. Virtual reality, there would be plugins for it. This is done in 3ds Max and then it's all rendered out. But if you've got a really strong rendering system and you can get something to that standard, then you could probably use, there will be more than one option in software that you could use to do it. So yeah, your visualizer would be able to tell you what they specialize in. Or if you're doing it in-house, then you can create a fly-through model and you would still be able to send it to that headset.
Absolutely.
You and me both. But yeah, you can save it as a bookmark. So the web link gets saved as a bookmark and you literally just click, you know, you click the button to enter the VR model. And then once you click that, that's what takes you into the immersive view. So you can still do that. You can do that from any software, anywhere. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes, so to combine the visual with other senses, yes, I mean, you could, in theory. Scott could run around with a candle while I wear the headset, you know, we could do...
We've done that.
Squirt water at each other while you're wearing it. You more than likely could, yes. You could create some sort of immersive experience. Actually, what's interesting is on the AC Marriott, we were talking about whether there was a brand standard to have music and things in the in the lobby and perhaps have something that engages with the senses, so you have your own scent and things. So you could, in theory, be wearing this headset and you could then have those scents round about you, have that noise playing, so you absolutely could combine it.
Tactile.
Tactile. If
you're asking your clients to choose a piece of furniture based on your visual, can you let them feel the furniture?
You could, if that was physically there in front of you. You absolutely could,
Not in the model.
But not in, I mean, your eyesight would still be completely taken over. That's where augmented reality might come in, or your web link. You could fall back on your web link and you could view that on a computer screen, move around it, but you could be in a furniture showroom and you could have the samples round about you and you could have the fabric samples as well, so you can touch everything that it's going to be upholstered in. Yeah.
I'll come in the future.
Yeah.
10 years from now, we'll be talking, someone else will be talking about this.
Sorry, did you have a question?
Just the external kind of views, was that just a series of stitch photographs that they put together, you know?
I believe the external view was stitch photographs, yes.
Yep.
And I mean, you can model, like you've seen in the Mylocanda apartment model, you can model your exterior views. It just is a lot more time consuming.
Yeah, they did that quite quickly, but just by stitching them together.
Just by doing, by doing views. From Street View, I think a lot of them will use as well, so it can be fairly true to life.
Yeah.
In your white model view of that apartment, could you have stitched together outside photographs whilst it was in a white model? Interior.
In the white model interior, I don't know if you could put a nice exterior on it. You probably could, but it would come in as a flat.
You just don't render the interior. It's almost two separate things. But I think the view for that particular apartment we had is really unspectacular, because that site, they now, it's, you know, it's like the college car park, and it's all demolished and things. So, yeah, I didn't think he wanted to spend. We're trying to keep the cost down on it and just not have him doing unnecessary work. So I think what we'll do when we're pushing the button for the next phase, the next couple of weeks, we'll get them to get the photographs and then stitch that together to get the exterior shots up John Street and around the side. So,
on a nice sunny day.
Yeah.
So it looks nice. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes?
So from the supplier's side, I don't understand the vendor software or whatever that kind of feeds all this, but some of the visuals look really quite specific in terms of the textures and patterns and designs that are on surfaces. Mm-hmm. Are you relying on specific information coming from the supplier to feed that through, or is it quite generic?
So to get it as true to life in a render, typically what we've done is we would send physical samples down to the visualizer, or we would have the visualizer come to us. So we would have, you know, our mood boards that have been approved by the client or finishes that we're proposing, and they can see them and make them as true to that as possible. Yeah. But on things like furniture, you can get either 3D models that they can import, or you can get like tech documents that have all of the dimensions, and the visualizer can build them. So like we touched on earlier with the plants that they had to build from scratch, some of the chairs and the lights and things were also built from scratch. So you will get some things, and then other things you'll need to create yourself.
But they do get a better output. So we were saying earlier, we've got all the samples for it over there for AC. If we send them the stuff, because if you send them the links, they can go on and take, you know, off the website, it's never as good. If they have that, they get a better understanding. So we tend to find we get a better, just package it up. We'll just mark it up and send it down, whether it's done via, well, most of our mood boards are always labelled clearly anyway. Mm-hmm. We tend to just send them a copy of those down and box it up, and then they'll just go through it. And then there's a bit of refinement sometimes. Things will come back, it's maybe not quite right, or doesn't quite look like the fabric. Maybe the colour's not quite right, the texture, and we just do that as marking it up, and that dialogue about changing it like we do with the CGI, and we tend to get there in the end. So again, it's been that process of working with someone for years and them kind of getting us and us getting them and knowing what we can and can't do and having that relationship again, which has been pretty vital to try and just get the output high.
Yeah. Any other questions at all? No?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure, man.
Thank you.